Professor Maria Laura Bolognesi.
She is an inspiring woman in medicinal chemistry, and she will deliver a talk about this topic. So, Professor Maria Laura holds the position of Professor of Medicinal Chemistry and Director of the Chemistry and Pharmaceutical Technologies degree program at University of Bologna. She received her PhD in Pharmaceutical Sciences and carried out postdoc work at University of Minnesota. Her research explores the development of small molecules in neurodegenerative and neglected tropical diseases therapeutic areas. Maria Laura has a track record of more than 160 publications in high-ranked scientific journals, including patents, and a lot of invited talks all around the world. So she was awarded with the position of distinguished visiting professor in different universities. And she's also associate editor of Journal of Medicinal Chemistry and serves in the advisory board of the European Federation for Medicinal Chemistry. Thank you very much, Professor. So we are looking forward to hear from you about this topic, and the screen is yours. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Filippa, for involving me for the second time in your initiatives. It's a big honor for me to contribute as much as I can. So as you told today, I'm not talking about science, but I'm very happy to be here, as I said already, especially because I'm in a very good company. I was listening very carefully to the fantastic talk by Krista, and I'm also looking forward to discuss today's topic with friends, a new person in the round table. Okay, so the title of my talk, I will share my presentation. So, as you see from the first slide, today I'm going to talk about women in medicinal chemistry. And I used this Latin title that maybe you know what it is, but I will explain better afterward. Per aspera ad astra. Okay, so as I said, today we will talk about gender balance in medicinal chemistry. I have to start by confessing that, yes, I believe that gender balance is an issue in medicinal chemistry. We cannot deny that, but I was maybe fortunate in my life, and especially in all my interaction with the EFMC, European Federation of Medicinal Chemistry, because I never felt held back or underappreciated by all the people I met at the EFMC and in general in the scientific community. So, as I said, I was fortunate, but we should not deny that the gender balance is an issue. I mean, we have not reached gender balance in medicinal chemistry, and we should aim for gender equality in the field. I started to be interested in these topics thanks to a very nice invitation I received in 2011 by ChemMedChem. I was already in the editorial board of this journal. And so together with Gloria Cristalli, she was an excellent Italian medicinal chemist. I mean, she was, because she has retired, but she's she was, at least for me, a role model. And so together we wrote this editorial, and this was during the International Year of Chemistry in 2011, where we wanted to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the Marie Curie Nobel Prize in chemistry. But when we started to write this editorial, we very first realized that there was not too much to celebrate. Because looking at the people who has been awarded the Nobel Prizes or even the Prize in Economic Sciences, starting from 1901 until 2019, 919 people have been awarded, but of them, more than 800 are men and only 53 are women. And if we restrict the focus to chemistry, so far only 5 women have been awarded a Nobel Prize in chemistry. So these are facts. These are facts that we cannot deny. So there is no gender balance in medicinal chemistry, but in general, in all the fields of STEM. I took this map where we can see how the percentage of researchers in STEM all over the world. First, I want to talk, as I said, about facts, but it's not always very easy to collect data because not always data are available. And but in general, looking at this map and looking at the colors, most of the countries all over the world do not reach gender equality in STEM. And if we want to focus on Europe, the situation is quite diverse because starting from the Netherlands, the percentage of researchers is around 25% of female research, while in some countries, and this is very nice, such as Latvia, Macedonia, Lithuania, the percentage of women is very high, and this is more, even more than 50%. But many of the countries are around here, so gender equality is not still a little bit far away. And as I said, I started with this first editorial to enter this issue on women in medicinal chemistry. And then I had the opportunity to meet a female scientist who is now a very good friend of mine, and Donna Arin. She's American, she's from University of Pittsburgh, and she spent some time with me as visiting professor at the University of Bologna. And she is very involved in the issue of women in medicinal chemistry. And so together we decided to write a second editorial that was published in 2017 in SCS Medicinal Chemistry Letters. And she enlarged the collaboration to another friend. She's Wendy Young from Genentech. And we had a great synergy among us. And we wrote this paper that we entitled Medicinal Chemistry, Where Are All the Women? Before going into details of what we wrote here, I want to tell something about what is a cliché and is a rivalry among women. Maybe I was fortunate, and I felt this kind of rivalry just very few times, but in all my experience of working with other women, I have learned that I have experienced myself that we should be as strong as we can, because I like this quote from J.K. Rowling, that we are only as strong as we are united, as weak as we are divided. This is just not a match just women, but can be extended to many other categories. But I want to highlight that because I think this is, for me, this is a mantra, it is very, very important. So we wanted to show that the pipeline, even in medicinal chemistry, was a little bit leaky. And we collect data. EFMC was always very supportive, as I said. And from the data that I collect at that time, unfortunately, what came out was that women in the board of the EFMC were represented only as 25%. I'm not so sure if this percentage has been improved. We can ask Rui Moreira in the round table, but in any case, I believe that we are far from the gender balance. And the same situation is shared by SCS Division of Medicine and Chemistry. These were data collected by Wendy and Donna. And at that time, only 13% of its membership were identified as female, and only 5 women have been elected as its chair. Even similar was the situation for the Division of Organic Chemistry. Then, always to collect facts, numbers, and data, I went into the position in academia in medicinal chemistry in Italy. And among 75 medicinal chemists with our full professor in Italy, only 21 are women. And this is especially interesting because if we look at the entry level, we have almost reached parity. So 45% at the entry level and only 28 are full professors. So this is a clear demonstration of the leaky pipeline. Then because I'm an editor, as you know, I'm editor of GEMEDCHEM, even Donna is editor of SCS Medicinal Chemistry Letters. We collect also data related to our journals and female corresponding authors of both in GEMEDCHEM of SCS Medicinal Chemistry Letters are less than 20%. And even in GEMEDCHEM, when I wrote my first article, the percentage was around 16%. So a very low number. For this reason, after we were aware that gender balance is an issue in medicinal chemistry, and this is very important, I also invite you to consider if your workplace gender balance is an issue. Because it's very important to be aware of that, because from that stage, then you can move to action. And in fact, in the same article, we suggested some concrete actions that we could perform toward gender equality. And we also acted in that way. And what we did was to publish two joint issues. Again, you know, we were collaborating together because we published a joint issue both in Journal of Medicinal Chemistry and SCS Medicinal Chemistry Letters, because as I said, I believe that collaboration is fundamental, especially everywhere and in all topics, but especially in this field. And I had the honor to lead this, to edit this issue, of course, together with my editor-in-chief, other female scientists from the editorial board. And we received so many publications. So we were overwhelmed by the publication. And so this was a further demonstration that the issue of gender balance is a hot topic in medicinal chemistry. And in addition to that, I want even to highlight that to publish an issue that is entirely dedicated to women in medicinal chemistry has multiple goals. And the first one, of course, is very evident, and we wanted to highlight the work done by women in medicinal chemistry. But also we wanted to encourage women to submit their work to be included in these issues. But maybe even more important was to urge men, especially those that have a leadership position, to use the opportunity of our issues to mentor and coach their students, their junior collaborators in the submission process. I want to highlight again how important is to help male mentors to understand what are the typical problems experienced by women scientists, because to have a good mentor is so, we know that it's so fundamental for our career. And so we want that our male colleagues are aware of the problem so that they can more effectively guide ourselves in our careers. And also we wanted to serve the people that were highlighted in the issue could serve as an inspiration, as role models to female students and in general, young investigators. After that, we also published always together in collaboration with Donna. Donna is always involving me in these she's very proactive and with many ideas and is involving me in all these initiatives related to women in medicinal chemistry. And again, because we wanted to help and guide the young generation, we wrote a second viewpoint, this was this year, in SCS Medicinal Chemistry Letters that we entitled A Different Kind of Medicinal Chemistry Toolbook. So what did we mean with that? We tried to share some advices, some suggestions, at least based on our experience, by sharing valuable resources and opportunity that could attract and retain women in medicinal chemistry. We were aware that these are not panacea, these are not solutions that fit all, but we made a list that we hope could be helpful. And we started among the resources, we listed scientific meetings, and I wanted to, in particular, to stress this meeting that has been recently organized by the group that is called Empowering Women in Organic Chemistry. This is dedicated to female scientists, but even myself, I was considering as a very important initiative for EFMC, the European Federation of Medicinal Chemistry Young Medicinal Chemists Symposium. So that's why I'm telling you, that's why I'm so glad today to be here, because I believe that you are doing a great job and the organization of this symposium is so important. Maybe, yes, I should tell something more about why scientific meetings are resources. Because there you can start to network, to present your work, and so not only to acquire some specialized skills, but also have a new perspective and fresh ideas and develops yourself professionally and personally. Other resources can be books. There are many. We just cited two of them, and the references are in our article, and also training courses. So what's the difference between a scientific meeting and training courses? Training courses are very good to provide specific and focused expertise. And these are fundamental to reach technical excellence. And also I was mentioning the European School of Medicinal Chemistry in Urbino, which is a sponsor by FMC. And many of you I bet that you know this school, and schools, rather the scientific meetings, are important because of the informal atmosphere. Maybe you can approach better important names in the field. You can exchange ideas with female scientists that could be role models. And so that's why we encouraged you to participate to training course and even affinity groups. So maybe we should do a little bit more on affinity groups because Affini Women's Group may provide specific training, access to leader in the organization, career guidance, networking. Maybe we can think about something to do as Women Chemist Committee has done at SES. We can think to do maybe something even at the European level. And going back to the importance of attend meeting, because you start your network, again, I believe that it's networking is so important, because to establish a network of colleagues and peers, regardless of gender, not just talking about women, it's so important. There are also studies on that, and especially for female scientists, the success in networking is directly related to success in the career. And so that's why I believe that what you are doing with the AFMC Young Scientist Network is something truly spectacular, and also your initiative on Twitter and LinkedIn. But always regarding this consideration, networking, and how important are different points for an overall successful career, I even invite you to read this viewpoint from Wendy Young that I mentioned before. And she has titled her paper, "It Takes a Village." This is in Italian, this "it takes a village" is not an Italian expression, but I believe it's a very nice metaphor, because to achieve a successful and rewarding career in medicinal chemistry, technical expertise is just a starting point. She points out that, of course, there are important features such as insatiable curiosity, passion, risk-taking, lifelong learning, team player, perseverance, resilience, and so on. But it's so important to create and making the so-called village. I mean, important to have the right network of mentors, colleagues, family, and friends. And of course, you have to work on that. This is not something that happens by chance. You have to work on that, but it's so important because you can learn, grow, gain confidence, and hopefully celebrate success. So this is another reading that I believe it's quite important. I want to go back to the title of my presentation, Per Aspera. What does this mean? So this is a Latin word. Per Aspera means ad astra. Astra means stars. So the meaning is through hardship to the stars. And this is the wish. That's why I want to finish with a wish, this presentation, because yes, the situation was quite tough, quite hard. If I remember of this lady here, this was the first female academic, the first female professor, and she was my university, at the University of Bologna, but that time she could only occasionally give public lectures, and only women were invited. So, and it was quite a scandal even to be a professor in science at that time. So the situation now it's not so hard as it was before, and even we have already stars, we have already a very successful example, tangible examples that the things are changing. I already did in my viewpoint, but I want to again highlight that in 2018, Krista was the first female medicinal chemist to win the NAUT Award. And Wunda Georg, who is my editor-in-chief in German Chem, she was the first female editor in NSCS journal. And she also received the 2020 Alfred Burger Award in Medicinal Chemistry. So we have already stars. So we have already passed from the very tough situation to the stars. And especially if we look, what makes me even optimistic is that if we look at the younger generation, what you people are doing at EFMC Young Scientist Network, I believe that our future is quite rosy because you have already, it's unbelievable, but you have been to reach gender balance in your network with just 50% of women. And the board is composed by 30 members and 8 are women, which makes a percentage higher than 50%. You have performed so well in your symposium because you had 43% of female speakers. And this can counterbalance what happened to the senior symposium where that was almost done at the same time, where the female speakers were just 0%. And also, I'm so proud of you, as Krista was saying, because I was really impressed by reading this perspective of graduate students from the University of Minnesota who contributed to the issue of women in medicinal chemistry, because they did a very profound and lucid perspective of the situation of a female medicinal chemistry in our field. And I also suggest you to read this one if you want to go into, you want to be more aware of this issue. So I want to finish by saying that tangible signs of progress are evident, but there is still much to do. And especially maybe because we are comparing our situation in Europe and in United States, but it's not the same all over the world. And that's why, as you know, gender equality is a goal number 5 of the United Nations Sustainable Development. And we know that to achieve these gender equalities as a clear positive ramification on all the other goals that have been established. So I want to close with a few lines that we wrote in the article with Donna and Wendy. And we know that we can do better. We know that gender equality is at our reach, but we need the support of both women and men. But we should not be too much worried for that, because our discipline thrives on collaboration and bringing diverse fields together to work towards a common goal. No pharmacologists, computational scientists, and so on, chemists, biologists. Therefore, to exploit synergy and taking this action should be natural for medicinal chemists to adopt. We are missing out on a large part of the population. We have important problems to solve. And so we should work together toward gender equality. But I want to go a little bit farther. And instead of using the concept of gender equality, I would like better to talk in terms of diversity. We should strive for diversity, that it's more than just balancing gender and race. I don't want to, I don't have time because I'm at the end of my presentation, but this is just more than balancing gender or race. Again, if you want to figure out, because we are scientists, diversity is a word that we appreciate a lot in medicinal chemistry and in chemical biology. Think about biodiversity, chemical diversity. These are very important concepts and tools in medicinal chemistry and chemical biology from the scientific point of view. And so I believe that diversity should be the right word to adopt in our MedChem chemical biology community. So with that wish for ourselves, I finish my presentation. I thank all the people, female and male, who I had the possibility to interact and share this concept, and all of you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Maria Laura. Thank you. It was a really interesting presentation, the insights into women in chemistry. And I think that you presented very valuable information about this topic. So before moving to the round table, we have one question for you.
Okay.
So Vanessa Noza just asked, just said that at CSIC, Spain, a recent report showed that the percentage of women in late career stages has gone worse in the last 10 years. So what do you think that we could do to avoid this situation?
Yeah, this is, of course, not an easy question. Maybe we could discuss these at the round table. Actually, I'm very proud of Spain, because in Spain, I know quite well the situation, because I was a visiting professor in Madrid. So I know the community, the Spanish community. And I also know that the president of the European Society, the Spanish Medicinal Chemistry Society, is a woman. So I believe that she will be the right person to fight against this trend, because she is very aware of what is happening. And I believe also she can do much better, because Beatriz is another role model. I respect for her, and I'm positive that she can work against that